Next. Oh, one of my favorite. This is the singular favorite piece of artwork that I own. I commissioned it from Jim Joe, which is super funny. So there's like this blog that's just demeaning and beats down young kids that are trying to be creative and just critiques them. It's called the internet.
Have you, Virgil, have you had misunderstandings creatively that have driven sort of a chocolate and peanut butter?
I have this general rule of never saying no, and that usually drives to a better result.
What time does everyone eat lunch?
Around 12:30, but in fact we are going to have lunch when you decide.
No, it's okay. People can eat, because I think that's the problem that we have now in 2018 is everyone owns every type of garment already. What's our signature twist in terms of things that you already have in your closet as to why you would buy it again?
Those are sort of like systems to communicate an idea. And a lot of what I think is missing from our culture is discourse. Whether it be critical, whether it be instructional, whether it be motivating, whether it be, here's how to actually do this, just don't be a consumer. My true sense is just be myself in any sort of scenario, so I'm authentic to that.
16th century, Renaissance artists like Da Vinci and Caravaggio discovered that by applying a succession of lights and shadows to different planes in their images, They were able to add dimension.
All that I wish I knew now is that one person would have told me like one like ounce of advice that wasn't necessarily like the rest of your career will be like an uphill battle, but more likely that there's all these sort of shortcuts that you can take.
So the only way to get to the end means is like start your domino effect, which is basically put out bad work. So I, for one, am not a perfectionist, and it's such a gratifying concept. Like, I have these Nike shoes on that I made that I really like, and the swoosh is falling off, and I like them even more. But for me, you'll see through the next slide, a project that was very pivotal is this film that I had made. If you go back and hit play, it was an idea called Pyrex Vision. So at this point, I might have been like creative directing with Kanye for like six, eight years. This was literally like the first piece of art or any concept that I decided on anything myself. Like 100%, like, what's my favorite color? What do I want to see? And the after effect of this, like, piece was, you know, for me, Off-White doesn't exist without this, but just in context, and I'll always make a cultural reference, this is like the era when Bari and ASAP Rocky make it down to the Rick Owens store with Palace on. You know, I saw this cultural moment happening in the streets that we were all participating in, and I felt like something needed to be created to mark that. So this is a 10-minute film. film that I made to be boring. The artist in the background who helped me shoot this is Jim Joe. To me, he's my Basquiat. You know, he's a particular, he uses words and phrases in a particular way that are part of his artist statement. And he has no identity, you know, he's two different people. He's like a grad art school student that's like on the rise, and that is an indication of like creating in a cultural sphere. Like, this is my artwork, but it's made by the personalities that are amongst it. And so this was only meant to be, you know, for the film. Like, Pyrex the brand, lo and behold, wasn't made to be a clothing line. That's why it stopped. Like, I would have never, imagine if I was up here and I was like, my clothing brand is Pyrex Vision. There's not that much taste in that. But this is the domino effect for me. So I want everyone who has ambition to find the domino effect, you know, create the project that's latent with intention and then see what happens after it.
All I did with the trademark of the quotes is I take things that are readily available. I use them in succession enough where they can become mine.
Now suddenly we have dimensional depth as the object and the background are separated by light and dark areas. This is the very basic principle of chiaroscuro.
Good, how you feeling? You good? Thanks for doing this. It's the key. It's gonna be a vibe.
Sure.
Yeah.
But just having a knowledge of what these different periods in art are can help you give understanding to what you're doing and why you arrive at these ideas. That they come, like the world evolved in this sort of way. That sort of like gave me a bit of context, so I was not like sort of fighting to be so different. It's just sort of owning my own voice in this like sea of differentness, and everyone sort of like trying to make a mark. Red slides are cheat codes. Basically, if you can answer them, you basically give yourself a cheat code, and that's like the sort of 2.0 of these talks that I'm using. And it's things that I've had to learn. I basically work at a feverish pace in a self-serving way just to find my signature. Like, what's my DNA? Every architect, designer, artist that I look up to, you know, whether they were doing period paintings or buildings in their early career to the end of their career, there's basically a through line. So what I would challenge you in your work, no matter what, is go back. You know, go back to when you were like, that your earliest memories or the way that you thought to organize something, the way you thought to organize your closet or what colors were your favorite. Back in that sort of like early rationale before you sort of learned too much, that's when your DNA started.
Well, one of the main sort of focuses of my work is to make sure that it's necessary and important.
The chiaroscuro technique is clearly showing dimensional depth, as light placement not only is giving us the spherical dimension on each object, but light and dark areas distinctively separate each plane in the image. Now let's use some lighting and other techniques to concentrate the viewer's attention in one portion of the image only. We can accomplish this by lowering the light intensity on everything that is not of primary importance in order to make the main point of interest stand out from the rest.
Part of off-white is a thought process, right? It's a, like on paper it could be seen as like a clothing brand or a fashion label, but when I look at it myself, it's just, it's a playground so that the world can sort of understand what ideas I have. 90% of them fall into like a clothing thing, but some spill off into a music thing, some spill off into a Travis Scott merch shirt, you know, or something. But I needed a bucket. And I urge you guys all as well to like not only think about your work, but think about it in a context larger than that, like what it means. I was super inspired by, you know, designers like Margiela. And like when you say Margiela, of course, it's a whole thought process that equaled into clothing. And to me, that's something to strive for in young design and young artistic expressions.
When you're in the perfect images that Angelo led off on, like
these instances of niche culture, which is like a crew, like B-boys, or kids in California, Dogtown B-boy, you know, like the birth of like a skate crew t-shirt, you're basically just adding value onto it. Like, this is a baseline cost, $4. But with the right idea in the right context, it can be something way more meaningful.
Yeah, you can even do it.
I left
like,
that blunt right there for you.
Do it.
I ain't wanna be, I ain't no. Know what I
mean. Yeah, just let it be known.
Yes, sir.
That's that.
Yeah,
This was my first store, but it made me think. And then I thought about, what do stores look like in the rest of the world? And I was like, why do all McDonald's look the same? Why do all Starbucks look the same? Why does all luxury brands, you know, look the same? And I thought, each store should be completely different, never duplicating one concept. So this is like filled my first question or first bullet point with that I don't want stores. Retail and commerce is not, it's not funny. there's nothing modern about that. You should buy something if it speaks to you. Otherwise, you should go for the experience. So.
But it's what's unique and something for you guys to think about because we're like teaching, not just talking, is design ethos. So my design ethos for the shirt was allowing everyone to merge all the graphics onto one. Like Awake's signature placement is still exists. No Vacancy logo is where it should be, you know, Oathen and Somewhere logo. And that's just, that's adding design from this. One thing that I think we should address too is like, it's obvious, they're great t-shirt designs and there's really bad ones. You know, I think we're not, we need to teach good design, into, not that it's an opinion, but it has to be, it has to have some premise to it. So that's just going off of the meaning tangent. But the inside label of this tea is also important. You know, I was coming to New York during the time of like these small brands on Rivington, you know, everywhere. It was all, it was a community and this retail mafia was also just like a pseudonym and like a phrase for how these brands move together. But I think it's super important. So the inner label, the, all, everything's important, you know.
It's with Off-White that I'm able to do my sort of reverse education trick, which is my reference points. I'm using clothing, graphic design, music to sort of highlight the attention on great designers and great moments in architecture that that wouldn't spread. It's that, that kickflip that ends up six kids doing the trick all over the world. It's like my idea of building buildings is to educate and shine light on great works of architecture while creating things that are in response to that atmosphere. So, documentary, like, it's super long. I wanted, this is a version of this talk. I want people who are into the end product to be able to see what goes behind the scenes. So, with a friend of mine, we shot this like super paint dry, long documentary of the making of a whole women's collection. Just because I knew one day I would get a critique that Off-White is uninspirational. So I just like, this content needs to exist. It's not for promotion. It's so that the kids on Prince and Mercer can see what designers don't show you. You know, how is there supposed to be a new generation of designers if, you know, they're not in fashion school or they're not, you know, no one's showing them how to transform from a printed t-shirt to like a couture gown that's made by hand.
This is a normal flat scene lit with a single light source placed at the camera's position. With flat lighting, the object appears like a circle. It has no roundness or depth. The moment that we bring the light around, we start creating modeling and the plane circle suddenly starts showing its spherical dimension.
That's Off-White. There's rules to be broken. You know, like the world isn't as literal as it needs to be. You know, ask Duchamp about this urinal and we'll explain to you. You know, this is a breakthrough too. What excites me the most is why the Pyrex hoodies have Caravaggio on the front. My mind, like I was an engineer, had I not had to take one humanities class that was on the Renaissance. So coming across Caravaggio's artwork, the idea that he invented a style of painting, chiaroscuro, like people painted, and then he invented a new, it was like, that's iPhone 6 level. Painting, source of light, cracks everything. So until, this is being an engineer, I didn't know that that genre existed. I thought art was just something that like rich people had, you know? And I'm like 5 years into engineering. It was like art, I've dedicated my life to it, but art wasn't something that I saw myself in, like art in quotes, you know, the big four walls of art. But the idea that Duchamp, like through a case of proving his point, like made this valid. And so what I'm using is I'm using that text the same way as Rem's Generic City, the same way as Margiela as an overarching concept to sort of add validity to how I see and how I decide if a product is done or not.
And I was like, of course, when I started my brand, imagine the time in between Pyrex and Off-White, which is like, hey, I did this project. I don't want to do Pyrex anymore. I want to do a real brand. Some kids try to deflate that whole concept and was just like hating on the fact that I, because what I had done is rugby, a polo brand was going out of business. I knew that. I bought up all the stock in the country. Because I was like, I was when I made the Champion sweatshirts, I was like, damn, I wanted to make a flannel and I forgot. Like, well, how can I get a flannel quick? And I was like, wait, this brand is about to go out of business. So if I buy it all up, no more exists. And of course, I paid like the sale price on it. And I was like, I'm just gonna print on it, and I'll like look at it, and I was like, how much does this look? Like, it's worth $500. Like, that's what it was worth to me. I was like, no one thought to do this. It's a really nice flannel. You know, it was like 500, let's go. You know, like I got cost, it cost to make up. And so, of course, like an attempt to deflate a young creative kid's vision, they put out this, and mind you, I'm telling you all this backstory, it was just like that little thing that you read on the internet that you're like, damn, like, my brand is over. I literally, when this era was, I was like, dang, that was fun while it lasted. Jim Joe, the artist that I keep bringing up, who's like, you know, my sort of like, you know, his brain is super on point. He's a graffiti artist and fine artist, but what he does is he just takes screen grabs of like interesting things on the internet and puts them in folders. And he has a super distinct hand style, like you saw it from the spray paint. And so I was like, hey, I'm doing a showroom. Can we collaborate on a rug? And I was like, hey, I'm going to be the only person in the world that has a Jim Joe rug. You know, Jim Joe did the Drake cover, Thank Me Later, or something like that. Or, you know, it, I don't know. Wait, what was it called? Yeah, if you're reading this, it's too late. In his classic handwriting that's written upside down and backwards. So I was like, hey, I want something in your handwriting. You know, like, let's do this. And what he sent me back was this, out of thin air. I was like, nah, I wanted something that was, like, awesome. I was like, you must have got it wrong. And he was like, the one, and he didn't even know the story. He didn't know, but it's something that he had saved. And I thought, what better rug for my showroom to have buyers come in and stand on top of this rug that explains my whole premise. The brand name's Off-White. On the back of the shirts, it says white. What's wrong with the word white? Is there anything? There's nothing. It's public opinion, or it's your own ideas embedded on a word, which is actually just a color, which sometimes isn't even written in white. It's written in black, or it's red. You know, that to me was like, I was like high-fiving myself. I was like, I made art, you know? But that was also juvenile. That was in the early phase. That was like, that's what I wanted out of the back. But then if you notice, this is the trick that I'm giving up. This is like, I was gonna use someone's name, but I'm not gonna use that because I'll get in trouble again, surely. One of my favorite fashion designers. Basically, his vintage clothes are worth an insane amount of money. There's a rationale behind that. You know, something that meant something at a time, it'll age really well. So Pyrex, like if you have, because I stopped making it, I felt like that was cheap, so it's not commercial item. To me, it's art, so they didn't get made anymore. But the early pieces of Off-White, like soon it'll never say white on the back. And the design, the theory that I had behind that was that I'm gonna move from these words and phrases that common opinion can add like different racial undertones, and then as the brand evolves, like those will be discarded, and then it's just eventually gonna say man or woman. Or it can say different terms that are evolving the question, in between what humans like overlay and divide themselves with, all the way to just cores of humanity.
So can never predict like what first project is gonna like lead to your like dream job or career goals. And this was my domino effect. I was just really into Caravaggio, like to the point where me as a creative person didn't realize you could invent. And that's what, you know, this painting represents to me, is to make their own design language. Literally, I'm very upset that it took me, I'm 37, so it took me this long to, well, I think it takes a lot of work and a lot of projects to define that. You know, yours might only be like 2 or 3 at this point, or it could be 13, but it's like if you, it's like, why work? You know, like, what are you working towards? You don't have, you know, you're either in or you're out. Like, you could just be chill. But obviously, I take a huge sort of passion about the creative work I do. It's not even work. It's just living for me. But so the things that make it more tangible is that they make sense and that there's a lineage, at least that I'm focusing on, like, a project. It, irreverent to whatever medium it is. Number two for me is obviously this thing that's probably getting a little bit tired, but get used to it because I'm going to keep using it. It's talking in quotes. It's basically humor. I like a couple people laughed, and that's literally the point of that tool, is to sort of insert humanity through conversation. You open up when you laugh. And obviously in our era where like vintage is more cool than like a popular trendy item, it's just us being ironic, you know, normcore, K-hole, that whole like rationale. It's real. That's you know, American Apparel, that whole thing is just the halo that we're in. So my way of doing that and trying to be the most like the most Duchamp version of ironic is speaking in quotes, because it allows me to say two things at the same time or be figurative and sort of precise. And I can basically design with a keyboard. I don't need Photoshop or anything else.
That's where the balance comes in. I feel like I haven't worked a day since the last thing I worked on was maybe like my thesis in at Illinois Institute of Technology, and that was 15 years ago. That was work, you know. I didn't necessarily want to do that. Everything that I've done since then is passion. I would do it for $0. I think I've paid, you know.
Can they, like,